bow to you. Oh my Allah, you are my Lord. I bow to you.
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Alhamdulillahi rabbil alameen. Wa sallallahu wa sallam wa baraka ala abdihi wa rasulihi nabina Muhammad wa ala alihi wa sahbihi ajma'in amma ba'd. Ahlan wa sahlan wa marhaban bikum. I welcome my dear brothers and sisters in al-Islam to the last episode in the series The A to Z of the Sahaba, The A to Z of the Companions of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Who is a Sahabi? An individual who met the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, believed in him and died upon Iman. How many were they? There were thousands and thousands. Some of the ulama state over 100,000 Sahaba. Ya Abdullah, Ya Amatullah. We've discussed in the series those important companions. We've spoken about those that we have something unique to talk about. We've spoken about those who were very, very close to the Messenger Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Ya Abdullah, Ya Amatullah, why are we talking about them? Why are we discussing their lives? Because they were the best of the best. They were the ones who were witness to the revelation upon Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. As the ulama have stated, that the enemies of Islam, when they tried to discredit the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and they failed, then they turned to discrediting the Sahaba. For verily, if you discredit the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, then the entire deen is destroyed and people would awaken straight away to your plots and your plans. But if you discredit the Sahaba, they are the ones who have carried down this knowledge to us. Some might say, well, they're just the Sahaba. You know, they're not the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Ya Abdullah, Ya Amatullah, the plots and the plans have been returned back against them. For verily we understand and we know that the one who picks and slanders the Sahaba, he discredits the companions of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, it then means that the entire religion goes down the drain. Because this noble Quran, because this Sunnah, because this lifestyle, this heritage, this information has all been passed down to us via the companions of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Walhamdulillah, in the series we've gone through the biographies of those whose names began with A. We spoke about Abdullah ibn Abbas, we spoke about Al-Abbas, we spoke about Aisha radiallahu anha, we discussed B, Bilal radiallahu an, D, Dihya al-Kalbi. We spoke about those companions whose names began with S, Sauda radiallahu ta'ala anha, those with the sword, Safiya radiallahu ta'ala anha. We discussed the biography of Ikrima, Khalid ibn Walid, Luhayya, MashaAllah, Tabarakallah. We also discussed the life of Hamza, Hassan ibn Thabit, Hassan, Hussein, Hamza, walhamdulillah. Where did we stop? We stopped on the biography of Umar ibn al-Khattab radiallahu anhu. You for Umar ibn al-Khattab. Ya Abdullah, Ya Amatullah, this individual, as we had stated, passed away at the age of 63. He was killed, assassinated, while he was performing Salatul Fajr in Medina al-Munawwara. And a coincidence that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam died at 63, Abu Bakr died at 63, Umar died at 63, and Aisha radiallahu anha also died at 63. Subhanallah. Does it mean that it's a sunnah to die at 63? No, brothers and sisters. The longer you live, the better it is for you, inshallah, if it is upon goodness, if it is upon ta'a of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, obedience of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Ya Abdullah, Ya Amatullah, you is also for Uthman radiallahu anhu. Uthman, dhun nurain, possessor of the two lights. Ya Abdullah, Ya Amatullah, this individual was the third of the Khulafa al-Rashideen, and he was the one who ruled the longest from amongst all of the Khulafa al-Rashideen. Uthman radiallahu an married Ruqayya and he married Kulthum. He is called the possessor of the two lights. He is that same individual that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, should I not have modesty for a person that even the angels are modest over? Even the angels have a level of modesty with regards to him, subhanallah. Ya Abdullah, Ya Amatullah, Uthman radiallahu ta'ala an. He was slaughtered in his home while he was at the age of 80 plus, while reciting from the noble Quran. He was under siege in his home for about 40 days. These rebels came from Yemen, they came from the areas of Iraq, they came from the areas of Egypt. And they said that we do not want him as the caliph. Remove him, we want someone else in his place. Some wanted Ali, some wanted this person, some wanted that person. And Uthman did not step down. He did not give in to that point. He gave in to many other points of theirs, and he allowed whatever they wanted. But as for stepping down from the mantle of caliphate, he did not. Why? Because the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said to him that Allah would cloak you with a cloak, and the munafiqeen would want to remove this cloak from you. And do not give in, and do not remove that cloak. And thus Uthman was firm in that matter. Some narrations that he was fasting on the day, he was fasting on the day that he was assassinated, Allah musta'an. They barged into his home and they slaughtered him, and his wife came to his defense and they also cut off her hand. Ya Abdullah, Ya Amatullah, this was the giant Uthman radiallahu an. So those matters which stand out in his biography, in his character, he was a very, very generous man. Uthman, he was the one who aided the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and the Muslims when he came to the expedition to Tabuk. He gave and he gave of his wealth. He gave a lot of his wealth. He benefited the Muslims in terms of armaments, in terms of animals, in terms of horses, etc., more than anyone else. When the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, who will purchase this bi'r, this well, and then make it a waqf for the Muslims, who came to the rescue? None other than Uthman radiallahu anhu. Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, whoever purchases it, for him is paradise. Uthman purchased it and gave it to the Muslims. Ya Abdullah, Ya Amatullah, he is the one who narrated the hadith, خَيْرُكُمْ مَنْ تَعَلَّمَ الْقُرْآنَ وَعَلَّمَهُ. The best of you are those who learn the Qur'an and teach it. And he learned the Qur'an and he taught it. Ya Abdullah, Ya Amatullah, because he understood that hadith, the best of you are those who learn it, and the best of you are those who teach it. Ya Abdullah, Ya Amatullah, Uthman radiallahu ta'ala an, after he was killed, that was the opening of great fitna. Because we had Muawiyah, who was the governor in Sham, also from the same tribe as Uthman, Banu Umayyah. He said that this is my relative and he is the caliph. How can he just be killed and someone else come in his place, etc.? We need to bring to justice the killers of Uthman. So Muawiyah was based in Sham and that was his stance. Whereas Ali radiallahu anhu had absolutely no part in the assassination of Uthman. He was like, we need to consolidate power and get things right. Then I can sort out the killers of Uthman radiallahu anhu. So they saw things differently. This eventually led to the battle of Jamal. Aisha, Talha, Zubair on one side, Ali on the other side. And then it eventually led to the battle of Siffin between Muawiyah, the forces of Muawiyah, and the forces of Ali radiallahu anhu. The ulama state that there's not been any individual ever in history who's married two daughters of one Nabi. He's married two daughters of that same Nabi. Nobody except Uthman radiallahu anhu. He was a person who was very, very modest. He was a person who had very high level of shyness. And as the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, that haya and Uthman, that the one who has the highest level of haya is this man by the name of Uthman radiallahu anhu. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam took the pledge from the companions, Bay'atul Ridwan. Bay'atul Ridwan, because they thought that Uthman was killed. Uthman was sent to negotiate with the Quraysh in Makkah al-Mukarramah. That the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is here and he wants to perform an Umrah. We're not here to fight, or we did not come with our arms, etc. We're just here to make Umrah like all other pilgrims and we will go back to Medina al-Munawwara. But the Quraysh were not hearing any of that. They put Uthman under house arrest. Rumor spread that he had been killed, subhanallah. So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam took the pledge of allegiance from the people there that we will fight, all of us will fight, and we will avenge the death of Uthman radiallahu anhu. Ya Abdullah, Ya Amatullah, he came back safely, walhamdulillah. But the point to remember is that during the pledge of allegiance, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam put his hand for the hand of Uthman. So he had his hand there, and then he put the other, and he said, and this is for the hand of Uthman. And the ulama state that the hand of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam for Uthman was better than the hand of Uthman for Uthman. Subhanallah. Ya Abdullah, Ya Amatullah. That was a short biography of this great individual, Uthman radiallahu anhu. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to resurrect us in the company of Uthman radiallahu anhu. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to grant us some of those qualities of Uthman. For verily haya, for verily modesty is something which only brings good, as the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam had stated. Ya Abdullah, Ya Amatullah. We move on to the next individual. And that is after Umar ibn al-Khattab. We have, for example, we have Umar ibn al-Khattab. We discussed Uthman. Now we move on to the letter W. And whose name begins with W? None other than Wahshi. Who is Wahshi? Wahshi was the slave of Jubair ibn Mut'im. And he had a deal with his master that if he killed Hamza, then he would get his freedom. Subhanallah, he would get his freedom. And he was a master at throwing spears. And that's why during the battle of Uhud, it is Wahshi who attacked Hamza and he killed Hamza radiallahu anhu. Ya Abdullah, Ya Amatullah. Then why are we talking about him as a companion? Because later on, Wahshi embraced al-Islam. Imagine the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam accepting the Islam of this man who killed Hamza radiallahu anhu. But Islam wipes away whatever came before it. At-tawbah yajubbu ma qablaha. Tawbah wipes away whatever sin came before it. Wahshi became a Muslim. And in fact, he did good because he was responsible for killing Musaylima, the false prophet. And he would say, I killed this giant in Islam, meaning Hamza. And I killed this giant of kufr, meaning Musaylima, the false prophet. Wallahu musta'an. Ya Abdullah, Ya Amatullah, we take a short break. When we return, we continue up to the letter Z, insha'Allah. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Alhamdulillahi rabbil alameen. Wa sallallahu wa sallam wa baraka al-amdihi wa rasulihi nabina Muhammad. Wa ala alihi wa sahbihi ajma'in. Amma ba'd, ahlan wa sahlan wa marhaban bikum. We continue bi-idhnillahi ta'ala. Before the break, we spoke about Wahshi. We discussed his biography. We said that he killed Hamza and he had also killed Musaylima, the false prophet. We discussed the biography of Umar ibn al-Khattab. We discussed the biography of who? Of Uthman al-Ghani, Uthman the rich one, Uthman dhun-Nurayn radiallahu anhu. We now move on to the next letter, and that is the letter Y. And whose name begins with Y? We have Yazid ibn Abi Sufyan. Not Yazid, the son of Muawiyah. Not Yazid, that individual who was the caliph during the slaughter of Hussein. But rather, this is another Yazid, the uncle of the other Yazid. Many Yazids we know. This is Yazid ibn Abi Sufyan, the brother of Muawiyah radiallahu anhu. He is a Sahabi, he is a companion. He is the son of Abu Sufyan. And he was one of the commanders in the area of Sham, appointed by Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu. And he eventually passed away there. There was the plague and he lost his life there. And he was put in charge. He was the governor of Syria after Mu'adh radiallahu ta'ala anhu passed away. Mu'adh passed away, then Yazid ibn Abi Sufyan was in charge. And once Yazid, the son of Abu Sufyan, died, that's when Muawiyah took over. That's when Muawiyah was appointed by Umar ibn al-Khattab. Because Muawiyah's brother, and then Muawiyah, walhamdulillah. So that was Yazid ibn Abi Sufyan, companion, radiallahu anhu. We move on to the letter Z, subhanallah. We are now at Z, masha'Allah, tabarakallah. Zayd ibn Sahal. Zayd ibn Sahal. Who is Zayd ibn Sahal? The foster father of Anas ibn Malik, radiallahu anhu. So Zayd ibn Sahal, he was married to Sulaym, the mother of Anas ibn Malik radiallahu ta'ala an. And we know that, for example, the mother Sulaym, once her child was ill and the husband had gone out and he came back, looked at the child, child's okay, he went out. Eventually, the child passed away. What did Sulaym do, subhanallah? That evening she beautified herself, put on perfume. Husband came home, he ate, then the husband and wife were intimate. Then Sulaim asks the husband, what do you think of a people that if they borrowed something from the people and the time is up now, they need to give the item back, but they refuse to give it back? What would you say about people like this? So her husband says, that's wrong. They cannot do that. So Sulaim says that, well, Allah had given us this gift of this child, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has taken the child back. The time has come, and the child has to go back to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The husband was extremely perturbed. He was angry. Woman, what is wrong with you? What are you doing? You make this food and all of this here. He goes to the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam the next day to complain. Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam makes dua for him, that may Allah bless you with regards to the relationship that you had with your wife last night. May Allah bless you. She eventually fell pregnant. They had a son who eventually had many other sons. And the narrator says they were all qurra of the noble Quran. They were all reciters of the noble Quran. The virtue of the dua of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Something else about this Zayd ibn Sahal is that he was a master at archery. Walhamdulillah. The next companion, and that is Zayd ibn Thabit radiallahu anhu. Zayd ibn Thabit, master when it came to the matter of inheritance. A master when it came to the matter of inheritance. He was also tasked with putting together the Mus'haf. Abu Bakr radiallahu ta'ala came to him and says to him, oh Zayd, that everyone trusts you. We want you to collect the Mus'haf, collect the copy of the Quran, put it into one book form. I think we need to compile it. And Umar was the one who suggested this idea to Abu Bakr. Zayd says, how can I do something which was not done by the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam? Abu Bakr says, I know. In fact, I said the same thing to Umar, but I think it's a good idea. It's the right thing to do. And eventually he did it, put it into practice. And Zayd ibn Thabit radiallahu ta'ala an, he was the one who compiled the noble Quran into one book form. During the caliphate of Uthman, he was chosen again to do a second compilation, walhamdulillah. He was an alim, he was a scholar of the first order, walhamdulillah. That was Zayd ibn Thabit radiallahu ta'ala an. We also had Zayd ibn Haritha, Zayd who was called Zayd ibn Muhammad, Zayd the son of Muhammad, subhanallah. Was he the son of Muhammad? No. Allah states in the noble Quran that Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is not the father of any of you men. He is not your father. Rather, you are not allowed to say Zayd ibn Muhammad because Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is not his father. Jayid. But they were very, very close. Zayd radiallahu ta'ala was gifted to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam by Khadija radiallahu anha. Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam set him free. Eventually, when his father met up with him, his father wanted to take him back, but he gave the choice to Zayd, and Zayd chose to stay with the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and not go with his own father. Subhanallah. He found in the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam an example, a better person. Even if he was in the khidmah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, that's better than me going away and settling somewhere else. Zayd ibn Haritha radiallahu ta'ala an, he was chosen to lead the Muslims in this expedition to face the Romans. The Battle of Mu'ta occurred and he was killed. He attained martyrdom, walhamdulillah. Zayd ibn Haritha radiallahu ta'ala an, although he came from a slave background, Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam put him in charge of that expedition. And there were other high-ranking sahaba also in that expedition. And there were certain rumblings, you know, why putting this man in charge? I mean, this man here, he was a former slave. There are nobles in the army here. Why don't put somebody of a high-ranking nature? Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam told them that Zayd is beloved to me and I will leave him in that position. He remained in that position and he was martyred in the Battle of Mu'ta. Walhamdulillah. The next companion, Ya Abdullah, Ya Amatullah, is Az-Zubair. Az-Zubair radiallahu an. Az-Zubair, the father of Abdullah ibn Az-Zubair, the husband of Asma radiallahu anha, the son-in-law of Abu Bakr radiallahu an, and Az-Zubair radiallahu an is one of the 10 who were granted the glad tidings of paradise. Az-Zubair ibn al-Awwam, as his full name goes. Zubair radiallahu ta'ala an, we know, is the cousin of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. For verily his mother Safiya is the aunt of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He embraced Islam in the early days. Who introduced Islam to him? As per our famous narration, it was none other than Abu Bakr who invited him to Al-Islam. So imagine, All the rewards of Az-Zubair are also on the scales of Abu Bakr radiallahu anh. Abu Bakr, the giant who maximized, he looked for quality, walhamdulillah. Ya Abdullah, ya Amatallah, Az-Zubair radiallahu ta'ala anh was also on the side of Aisha radiallahu ta'ala anha in the battle of Jamal. Ya Abdullah, ya Amatallah, his son.